En dan beginnen we vandaag met de eerste aflevering van een hele nieuwe serie. Spiral Into It. Een serieprogramma uit Amerika. Ze zijn in het Engels over, zeg maar, conspiracy theorieën over wat de Amerikaanse regering doet. Nou lijkt dat allemaal een beetje een droombeeld, een waanbeeld, een angstdenkbeeld van een aantal mensen. Maar de laatste maanden is duidelijk geworden dat met name tijdens allerlei oorlogen toch wel technologieën worden gebruikt waarvan later pas blijkt of ze al dan niet schadelijk zijn. We noemen maar het gebruik van UD. Ofwel niet verrijkt uranium, depleted. En dat is dus gebruikt in granaten, maar misschien is het ook gebruikt in onderdelen van vliegtuigen. En de vreemde serie ziektegevallen die we uit de Bijlmer kennen, zou daar iets mee te maken kunnen hebben. Het was tenslotte een Israëlisch vliegtuig. Zat er misschien militaire lading in? Hoe zat dat? Ondertussen blijkt dus dat er leukemiegevallen mogelijk gerelateerd kunnen worden aan dat gebruik van dat depleted uranium. DU. Heel interessant dus deze serie Spiral Into It in het Engels. Een beetje conspiratieachtig, maar toch wel iets wat past bij Kleurnet. De eerste aflevering.
This is the greatest threat to democracies. This is the greatest threat to personal freedoms. These are the greatest invasions of personal privacy that have ever been contemplated by man.
What is happening? Something is going on. Can you feel the way?
Hi, I'm Fisk Smith, and in this episode of Spiral Into It, we would like to present the research of Dr. Nick Begich. Dr. Nick Begich has done extensive research into secret military technologies that demand public debate and discussion. Although the following research presented in this episode might seem like science fiction to most of you, these technologies are being deployed today. We would like to thank our friends Terry Marmerstein and Tim Coleman, who have generously lent us this footage. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Nick Begich.
HARP is the high-frequency active auroral research project, which is operated by the United States Air Force and Navy. It operates in Alaska. It is a large radio frequency transmitter that's designed to create both offensive and defensive weapons effects. It's a machine essentially on the ground that couples with natural components of the environment, basically converting those natural components into part of that machinery in the sense that it connects energy being artificially produced to natural energy and then changes that natural energy in a number of different weapons applications. For instance, over the horizon radar looking around the curvature of the Earth, being able to distinguish when you detect incoming objects which ones are carrying nuclear payloads, for instance, being able to destroy those objects by increasing the power level sufficiently to cause computer error on those incoming craft to knock them out of the sky. The other things the military points to is the idea of Earth-penetrating tomography, which in plain language means would be comparable to X-raying the Earth or looking into the Earth several kilometers deep. And the idea there is to find underground nuclear facilities, underground installations. That application was proven up in 1996 by military testing in the field. The other things are communication with submarines, utilizing that same technology, being able to penetrate deep into the sea to be able to communicate at higher data rates than other technologies that are currently available. The other things that the military points to that become interesting is communication interference, the ability to knock out on a hemispheric basis or knock out the communications of an entire country, while at the same time being able to carry your own communication. In other words, denying your adversary and being able to maintain that communication threshold that you need in battlefield environments. The things that come out that are more on the edge in terms of where the military is willing to acknowledge deal with the issues of weather modification and the potential impacts on human health and psychology of systems operating within the frequency ranges that HARP operates in. The follow-on to the HARP research done by Dr. Bernard Eastland, the person responsible for the original patents, he has recently completed a paper for the European Space Agency on weather modification, specifically knocking out tornadoes using HARP type apparatus. That was presented in Europe in 1998, well received at the end of 98, resulting in a follow-on contract, as well as a more recent paper presented in Houston to a group of representatives, including NASA. That was very well received. The issue of weather modification is becoming increasingly important to the military, and HAARP, by virtue of the way it works, has the ability to influence weather patterns in a regional area, which we all know now, based on El Nino. And El Nino, that what you do in one area of the world can have tremendous impacts and unpredictable impacts around the planet. So it's one of the main areas of concern. The thing that also has happened is, in terms of one of the Russian techniques, was a virus that they developed. And this was written in a magazine called Perimeters, which is the U.S. Army War College's publication. And they had done an extensive review of Russian research. In fact, we cite all of this in our current work. And one of the things they came up with was a virus that, through the computer system, that is called the 25th frame effect. And during every 25th frame of any visual material, they can create images that are so fast that you don't perceive them. But these images can actually cause you to act in a certain way. In other words, they did an experiment where they had people getting this message to go get them cake, and they wanted to test it. And so people from all over this building start showing up with cake to this one office, not understanding why they were doing it. That has been proven to be possible. And when you think about the interconnectedness of the internet, as an example, and as a delivery system for this technology, in fact, the virus, the Russians tagged with the name, the virus is called 666, which is just bizarre. I mean, from a religious perspective, you go, wait a minute, you know, this is a little unusual. How do they get that number? And I have no idea whether they did it as sort of a stab at the rest of the world, or whether it just happened to come up as the next number in the sequence of events. But the idea that this technology exists and that it's cited in very credible literature is our area of concern, because when the debate begins and people think about these technologies being used, this is the greatest threat to democracies. This is the greatest threat to personal freedoms. These are the greatest invasions of personal privacy that have ever been contemplated by man. The idea of affecting people at an energetic level instead of just ripping through tissue is more destructive. I mean, we're energy, atoms, molecules, and then body. We're affecting things at a very base level that affects the entire living system, the entire living organism, in an undetectable way. And therein lies the danger, because these systems can be deployed without our knowledge, and they're not so sophisticated that terrorist organizations couldn't also create them. I mean, could you imagine an electromagnetic pulse weapon being driven down Wall Street and knocking out all of the computers dealing with the financial systems of the world? It would create a greater panic than all the bombs that have been dropped in the Middle East in the last 20 years. You know, what happens with most of the military research when it gets into these areas that are highly controversial and potentially controversial, they don't get much scrutiny. I mean, black projects, projects so secret even the U.S. government doesn't know what they're funding, and the Congress doesn't know what they're funding. In the Air Force budget in 1997, 40% of the equipment budget, which is huge, according to the Washington Post, were black-funded projects that had virtually no accountability or oversight. When you look at a document, it was Revolution Military Affairs and Conflict Sort of War, produced by the U.S. Army War College in 1989. It talked about the evolvement of electromagnetic weapon systems and the fact that those systems violate American values and American principles of law. And instead of saying, okay, we can't do them based on that, instead it was, how do we change the American value system so they'll accept these weapon systems? That's an upside-down equation. And then they're developing them in the dark, so you're not even knowing conceptually what they are. And then they're changing values based on events that are synthesized or amplified, whether it's terrorist events. In this case, they suggested terrorists and international drug traffickers being the first targets, because we would all look the other way as Germans looked the other way in the late 1930s, is a basic equation. But the idea that you could use these against the villains of the world, and somehow that those villains of the world are guilty first, and there is no trial, there is no jury, there is no presumption of innocence. These are American values, these are democratic values that cannot be lost sight of, regardless of how villainous we might think an individual is. There's a due process, and that due process of law is what makes us civilized people. Echelon is real interesting, and recently it made 60 Minutes, and our work on this has been out for a while. That's been a big issue in Europe for the last few years. Glenn Ford from Great Britain raised the issue first in the European Parliament. We spoke with him about a year and a half ago. And Echelon is a joint project of the United States, Great Britain, Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. And what it's intended to do is essentially, it started at the end of World War II, and it was signal surveillance groups. And so they were monitoring electronic communications. But that's become much more sophisticated, because what has happened now with the advent of supercomputers and digital communications and the growth in this area, where one country couldn't spy on its own citizens on a wholesale basis, another country could. So they had this agreement where we would spy for each other. And that information now, today, is taken from all telecommunications systems, faxes, emails, everything. And keywords and key phrases are submitted by various government agencies. And there's 300 agencies in the 5 participating governments. What they then get is a daily download of all of those conversations, all of those faxes, all of those emails that click through those. They go to tens of thousands of people. I mean, as an example, in the United States, congressmen kept driving by this one building wondering what the heck it was in Southern Maryland. There's thousands of cars and employees and everything. It turns out it was an NSA project, $1 billion building, 7,000 employees, and no line item in the budget. It was black funded. And that was just for domestic surveillance. When you think about a surveillance technology on that level, it essentially means there is no privacy in your communications. More than that, new technologies in biometrics, measuring various aspects of an individual's body, in this case, voice recognition systems, they can take a few seconds of a voice and imprint it in the same way that you imprint a fingerprint. So anytime that you're on their digital networks talking, your voice can be picked out, whether you're in Europe, whether you're in the United States, whether you're anywhere in the world, if you're making those communications across their systems. So they can basically track individuals. Another example of that tracking, as it extends into the cell phone industry, Swisscom was used by the police at one point, because they not only tracked the phone calls, but within 100 meters they were tracking location and maintaining the record for 6 months. These are things that are happening because they can happen, because technology is cheap enough now where to get these extra little bells and whistles is very inexpensive. It's not 6 people in 2-man teams following someone around that's highly expensive. Now it can be done for pennies. And as technology increases, and the computing power is expected to increase up to 1,000 times in terms of computing power in the next decade, as it increases, our transparency to the government becomes more and more transparent, whether it's the thumbprint at the bank, the scanning of your groceries in the grocery store, your medical records, your passport records, your property records. All those databases are now integrating, and at a touch of a button, an individual's life can be before anyone who has an interest in finding out what it's like. On the other hand, the government becomes more opaque as we become more transparent. We can't look into our government and see what's going on in the way that we should. It's exactly the opposite of what should be occurring. I mean, we don't need to reveal the national secrets and sense of how to build these apparatuses, but we should be able to debate the concepts themselves. What do they do? What are the implications of what they do? That's the proper forum, public debate on those issues, so we can direct our military, direct our government the way we want them to go, not having them trying to create values for us to direct us on which directions we need to go. You know, the fact of a lack of accountability in military sectors, and the idea that the more you have in secret, the more power you give to those organizations in the sense of being able to manipulate outcomes. I mean, look at politics as a general rule around the world. It used to be fused by public debate and discussion. Now it's polling, focus groups, figuring out how to spit back at the public what they want to hear rather than what's really going on. The idea of the Europeans really hit it on the head when they looked at all of these technologies. They call them the technologies of political control. That's what the European Parliament refers to these technologies as. And that really describes what's going on. The idea that if you manipulate the population, you survey, you feed back the information the population wants to hear, you're essentially manipulating for political outcome. And Zbigniew Brzezinski, in the early 70s, predicting many of these technologies, said that no matter who was in power, liberal or conservative, the temptation to use these technologies to further their political ends would be greater than the good sense to restrain. And that's someone who later became National Security Advisor to President Jimmy Carter. The idea that they would flow in this direction. And you see it. I mean, we saw the last indications that we really saw that really struck home to a lot of people was in Seattle during the World Trade Agreement demonstrations. And we cite sort of what happened there in the very end of our current book, because it's a wake-up call, the idea of creating martial law, bringing in the military, and the whole approach to dealing with civil disobedience within the boundaries of law, because there's a very small portion that were actually creating the disturbances. And yet, what happened? We saw this Gestapo type of approach to dealing with American citizens exercising their First Amendment rights of assembly and free speech being crushed and beaten in the streets, gassed with gases that are illegal to use in international conflicts, a declared enemy of the United States, and yet we can use them on our own citizens. The outcry that started there is an outcry that we hope continues. That chief of police was brought down, and the political parties and individuals that were involved in that will be brought down in the future. And we cannot forget what happened in Seattle. Americans cannot give up their right to voice their opinion. And when you look at the WTO, it's been a big issue in Europe. There have been similar demonstrations in Europe. Here, that was the first one, and it was taking us back to a time, say, in the 60s in the civil rights protests and the death and destruction that results from that. Are we going to repeat that again in this millennium, beginning this millennium? Are we going to beat our citizens in the street as they did in the early 60s? I think not, and I think that's where Americans have to buckle up, get to the table, and make sure our politicians and our leadership knows that we won't tolerate a regime that is that oppressive and suppresses the freedom to have the kind of debate that Americans and the rest of the world is entitled to. You know, one of the interesting things that came up when Secretary of Energy O'Leary was talking about experimentation coming out of the Atomic Energy Commission as an example, she was talking about the fact that over 500,000 Americans had been victimized by the United States government in experiments without their consent. This included blacks in the Southeast being given syphilis and allowed to essentially die. In Alaska, it was a radioactive iodine being given to a native Alaskan to see how that would react in Arctic climates. Prisoners incarcerated people that were experimenting on military personnel in large part who have essentially no political rights. I mean, they can't start arguing about this. They throw them in the brig. You know, when you look at the history, the idea that they're acknowledging 500,000, a half a million people have been victimized by the United States government, and absolutely no accountability, in the sense that there has not been one person brought before a court and held accountable for what they did to their own citizenry. And yet, 50 years ago at Nuremberg, we hung them by the neck for the same thing. Americans are entitled to full disclosure. We're entitled to know who the villains who have perpetrated these atrocities on American citizens are, and they need to be held accountable. At the same time, we need to create a mechanism by which we allow people to come forward voluntarily, acknowledge what has happened, clear their conscience, and in that instance, I think we should use the South African model of forgiveness. Let's give people an opportunity to come forward. Let's clear the deck on our past. Let's build a future that takes what we've learned and applies it to building a stronger, a more positive and real humanity, and not an illusion of democracy as we maintain a system that destroys the very essence of who we are. You know, I think there's a couple things that are very important for average people to understand is we are not powerless, first of all. I mean, very few of us, initially just a couple of us, took the HAARP project on, and we got it all the way up to the European Parliament. We got resolutions out of them, which is the beginning steps for political change. What we've learned in all of this work is everyone has a part to play within our own circles of influence, whether we have our friends and neighbors and the people we work with. And some people have different spheres of influence that affect political, scientific, and other parts of the community. The main issue for us is get informed on these issues, become familiar enough with them, know what the material is, and when those congressmen and those representatives come to your door asking for your vote, make these the issues that you confront them with. Bring them into that political process, and don't feel powerless in doing so. I mean, the big issue that I always hear is, well, everyone's so apathetic, no one gets involved. That's great. If only 20% of the people are involved politically, you only have to convince 11% that you're right and get them to vote. Get them engaged. If you don't like who's running, find those people in your community that mean something, that say something, that speak the kind of truth that you want to hear and that you want to see implemented in law, and recruit them help them, get them involved, and get them to seek those public offices, starting at the local level and working your way up. That is the only way that we can reverse this trend. From our perspective, if the American public would begin to do that, and we continue our efforts at informing the public to give them the tools necessary to engage that debate, and we continue to work with European governments to put pressure on our own government, eventually that information will merge in the United States Congress, and we will start to see the steps in the right direction. We saw it with blinding lasers. Once people understood what blinding lasers were all about, they were outlawed internationally. They're gone. It didn't take but a couple of years to achieve that. We can do that with these systems as well. You know, one of the things that comes up is, you know, how does all this happen? How do scientists find themselves in this place where they're engaged in science without considering perhaps the moral and ethical consequences of their actions? And I mean, scientists get excited, enthusiastic about the work they're in, and they focus very intensely on that work, and they sort of lose sight of what are the implications of everything I'm doing in many instances. And part of it is in scientific studies, curriculum, in colleges and universities, ethics should be required. The ethics of science should be required as a major component for any professional degree where you have the possibility of impacting other human beings in the way in which science does. When you think about governments, what makes governments powerful? Their science, their technology. Look at who's powerful in the world, and they have high science and high technology. High science and high technology also needs to be translated into the classroom and into the average person's syntax of information. I mean, we need to know about technology, not at that level, but enough because it drives so much of what we do. And the things we're teaching kids in school, I mean, at the elementary level even, and the junior high and high school level. I went recently taking my own children to go swimming at a pool, and there's a high school dance, and everyone's coming in their formals and their tuxedos, and all of us remember those days. But it's different now. Now they get stopped before they get into the parking lot, asked to leave their car. Their cars are searched, their purses are searched, their person is searched. What civics lesson are we teaching kids? That random search and seizure is okay? That the invasions of personal privacy is okay and routine and should be expected? I think not. That's where the problem starts. We need to emphasize civil liberties. We need to emphasize what that Constitution means, not just studying its history. We need to talk about the essence of what those concepts mean and how they're violated in the United States and how those violations represent huge intrusions into our personal freedoms and why that's important. Things that are coming, genetic typing of people, you know, the idea is, oh, well, that's okay. What's wrong with that? Well, the problems with that is, what if you have a propensity to cancer? Doesn't mean you're going to get it, but you may have that indicator. So does that mean you don't get insurance? Does that mean you don't get the job because the employer is worried that you might get cancer sometime in your career? These are very important issues, and the issues that are facing us now and in the future. And what we've done with our work is try and take that information that we're so desperately trying to catch up with. I mean, technology from the invention of the wheel to where we are today doubles every 9 to 10 months. We need to get a grip of what all that technology is. And what we've tried to do is put that into an understandable form, so instead of catching up, we can project out what's coming and begin to think about the solutions and the mechanisms to make sure that our science lines up with our values and that our values are emphasized in a way that enhances humanity and doesn't destroy it. You know, the whole issue of what happens next is really up to the American people and the world community, in the sense that if we do nothing, these systems will be developed, they will be deployed, and by the time they're fully deployed, and many of these things are already in operation, like the Echelon project we talked about earlier, we can try and look back and say, oh no, how do we fix all these things that have already happened? And yet more is happening in that instance. Or we can take preemptive action now. Let's get the information out there. Let's talk to each other and move forward on a political solution. And in the end, I believe we can reach it. I wasn't as optimistic 6 years ago when I began, but watching what we've done with just a small group of people focused on these issues and taking these issues forward and making people aware of them, we know it's possible. With just a few people, tremendous potential is there. And our objectives as individual human beings should be to help each other realize our full potentials in actualizing the reality that we want created around us, because we all create that reality and we all can make a difference. It doesn't require a big organization. It doesn't require any of that. It only requires that each of us take responsibility for what we can do, and not under some huge pressure and burden, but do it in the course of daily life, have conversations, get informed and address that. Occasionally write a letter. Take 10 minutes a month when you're writing out your bills to write a letter to the editor, a letter to a congressman. Just put it on your list. Check it off each month. 10 minutes a month, people do that. It will have a tremendous impact in getting this issue elevated. You know, get involved in the things that are important to you, whether it's these issues or other issues, and do a little bit. And it adds up. There's millions of other people doing the same thing. You know, one of the things that comes up is, you know, with all of these controversial areas, whether it's UFOs or weapon systems or, you know, whatever, for people to belly up to the bar and want to talk about them from the scientific community is a little difficult to get to happen. There are some ways, though, I think that could be created. The environment for where that could happen could be established. And one of those things that we did at the local level in Alaska, we set up and we have operating ombudsmans, which you can go to anonymously. You can report a complaint of public concern. They have subpoena power, investigative power. They can go in and look at those things. They then prepare reports, which are public reports that everyone gets to see what's going on inside their government. We have whistleblower laws that we were able to put in the last few years so that when a person who's in public employment, working for the government, goes before a public body to disclose what he believes or she believes is information important to the public that may violate their supervisor's wishes, they're protected and insulated, so they have the right to do that. Those models, in conjunction with the South African model of forgiveness, there's an opportunity. If we did that on a national scale, there's a lot of people in their 60s, 70s, and 80s now that are going to be dying soon that would really like to clear their conscience of the things that they were involved with in the past. And at the same time, if we don't want the situation that we had in Kosovo, where for hundreds of years the anger festers, and this is what they did in South Africa by creating tribunals, ways for people to come forward, confess, say what they had done freely, and were forgiven. Forgiveness has to be a component, but disclosure, we have to give people a way to be protected. Think of the poor guy in Zurich who disclosed the shredding of bank records and what he went through. You know, that takes a tremendous amount of courage, and the level of courage we can't expect from average people unless they're on an equal footing and have the insulation of an institution that allows them to come forward, disclose what they need to disclose, and set a time frame. Give people a year or two to accomplish that, and if they fail to and they're identified in the process and the evidence is there, reinvent the Nuremberg trials and bring them before the public to be accountable for their actions in the criminal courts. But otherwise, give them the opportunity to be forgiven, because the public does need to know. And when the public knows, this government will change and the transparency will begin to return to this government. And this same concept can be applied around the world. And that concept, I believe, can lead to full disclosure in all of these controversial areas and lead to conclusions that build the peace, that build humanity, and take us to a much better place than the place that we exist in today. My father was in the United States Congress, and he was in the Alaska Senate for a number of years. And this idea of conspiracy always comes up. And I think about, you know, sort of my family's politics, and several of us will get around the table and we'll start talking about what's going on politically around us, and we'll lay out a strategy. Now, if you're part of that discussion or you support what the outcome is, it's just a discussion or a strategic planning session. If you're on the outside and you don't like what you're seeing, it's a conspiracy. You know, I mean, it depends on what side of the fence you're on. And at every level, from the very highest levels of government and business, those discussions take place. In the course of business, they figure out how do we get larger market share, how do we create consumers. I mean, all of that kind of thinking. When you look at it from the outside, it's like you're conspiring against my interest. And they are, in the sense that they're doing things that aren't in your interest because people act in their own self-interest. Corporations who have a self-interest that's driven strictly by the profit margin has a very narrow view. I mean, that is their self-interest. Government, too often, many politicians' self-interest is political survival. So they want to just do what's necessary to continue to be reelected and to attract the kind of money that gets them reelected. I think it's not so much, I know enough about government and have worked in government long enough to know it's impossible to have an intricate conspiracy regulating every detail. In fact, my colleagues laugh when I say, government sort of oozes its way to the finish line because it doesn't really get there in a direct route. It just kind of rolls out in a squishy situation. Well, when you think about the millions of people working in government, a complete conspiracy is out of the question. Is there planning? Is there directed action intended to influence behavior? Absolutely yes. That is the essence of politics, which is why we need to engage in that process. Because we either become manipulated or we become persuaded. And the difference is, persuasion means you deliver the information, the facts, and you allow the public to make conclusions based on that information. Manipulation is you twist, turn, spin. That's all of what our politics has become. Poll, focus group, spin, try it again. And it's a false politic. It's a shallow, disjointed, fractionalized politics that yield no long-term results that are positive for the American public or anyone else.
Spiral Into It, committed to presenting multimedia that stirs the collective mind, shares sacred objectives,